doing, sir?
You doing good?
Good afternoon. We'd like to call the Durham City Council work session to order at 1:28 p.m. Certainly want to thank all of you for taking the time to be here this evening. And I assume that most of you are here for one particular item, and that's the City Manager's report on the Durham Human Relations Commission and Civilian Police Review Board. What I intend to do this evening is to follow our normal work session agenda. This is not a public hearing, but obviously there's quite a bit of interest on this particular item. What we'll do is to have the city manager to present his report to the city council and to the public, allow time for any of the city council members to comment, ask questions of the city manager, and then at the appropriate time, if those of you who are here have comments, we're going to allow time for that. What I need to do is to find out how many persons want to speak so I can allocate the amount of time for each speaker. So those of you who have intentions of speaking, I would ask that you go to the clerk's table to the left. There's a card that you can sign up, your name, address, and et cetera. At the appropriate time, you'll be recognized for comments that you might have. Having said that, I'm going to ask the clerk if she would call the roll.
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. Councilmember Brown.
Here.
Councilmember Cotati.
Here.
Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
We're in a closed session doing evaluations of the city clerk and city attorney. There was a motion to continue that meeting until Tuesday the 2nd at 5 p.m. The motion was made by the Mayor Pro Tem and seconded by Councilman Steve Shule. There was also a motion to go back into open session. That motion was made again by the Mayor Pro Tem and seconded by Councilman Eddie Davis. Let me ask first, are there comments by priority items by the City Manager?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good afternoon, everyone. No priority items.
Likewise, City Attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
Likewise, City Clerk. All right. The first item, comments by members of the council. If not, the first item are the administrative consent items, and item one is city clerk's office. Durham Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission appointments and the Durham City County Environmental Affairs Board, and those ballots have been passed out and collected by the clerk. On the departmental items, item three on the city manager's office, on the city manager's office, item three, readoption of city county emergency operations plan.
Mr. Mayor.
Recognize.
I don't need to pull it, but I just want to ask, in the future, it'd be nice to have a red line version to see the, actual see the changes. So.
Okay, so noted. Item four is the city manager's report in response to recommendations from the Human Relations Commission and Civilian Police Review Board, and we'll come to that after we've gone through the rest of the agenda. Item five is Community Development Department. Item five, pull item five. Approval of public and private pre-development costs for the redevelopment of Southside Rental Phase 2 with McCormick Barron Salazar Development, Inc. Item six on the finance department. Item six is bid report for July 2014. Item seven is the Office of Economic and Workforce Development Grant Projects Ordinance, recognized in 2014 State of Durham's Economy Breakfast Revenue Superseding Ordinance 14325. All right, pull that item also. On the Public Works Department, telecommunications license agreement with CenturyLink Communications Link LLC. Item nine is professional services contract, ST272C Duke Gregson's Curb Extensions. Pull that item also. Item 10 is contract with Bio Habitats, Inc. for alga turf scrubber at Mobile Pilot Systems Installation Operations. We're going to have a presentation on that. Okay. On 11, approval of 2012 local water supply plan for the city of Durham. Item 12 is 2014 unscheduled pipeline repairs contract. And we have citizens' matters to be heard at 1 o'clock. Item 13 is Joseph Bush Fan. Is Joe Bush Fan present? If you come forward, please.
Hey, how's everybody doing? Oh, boy, oh, boy. You ready? Okay, I just wanted to give you all an update on what's been going on up the Andrew Driver project there. And,
excuse me, most of us know you, but you may want to introduce yourself.
Okay, I'm sorry. My name is Joseph Bush Fan, owner operator of Joe's Diner on the corner of Andrew and Driver. Sorry about that. Kind of excited here, a little bit nervous, but I'm all right. Okay. Well, back to the Andrew Driver corridor here. We're up here, and basically we started this project around October of last year. We came in under budget, and basically we came in 3 months early as well. Am I gonna move this mouse here? But my main reason coming here is to say thank you to council, because we've had a very successful project up there, working hand in hand with the city. We had a lot of emphasis there from Mike Hughes, Keith Chadwell, Chris Dickey, Kevin Dix. We also had a lot of emphasis from Fred Smith, as well with Ron, Skip. Yeah, I'm trying to get this thing rolling here. Okay. All right, so we had Ron Smith and Kyle Carlson in them. It's been a real collective effort up there on the corner of Andrew and Driver. No doubt we've been moving forward. We're having the, got it.
It's trying, I'm trying.
You gotta put some quarters in it. All right, as you can see where we started out from what it used to be like up there on the corner of Andrew and Driver. And this is the old Andrew. That used to be the old printing shop there. And that's the other side of Driver Street. And that's the new side of Driver Street. And that's the new side of Andrew. In front of the Andrew Baptist Church there. And that's the new intersection that's been placed there. And the other side of Andrew going down towards Miami that way. But this has been some serious work to be done up there. I mean, it's taken a lot of effort and time, and the businesses have suffered a lot, but I think in the long run it'd be well worth it, you know. But my most thing is that I just want to say thank you, and I invite you guys to come on up and see, you know, what we accomplished up there. All right.
All right. Well, we appreciate you taking the time to come and present that to us. I'm sure most of us have traveled that area. I'm over there quite frequently, but I want to thank you all also for making the investment that you did initially to go into that area, and we hope a lot of other good things are going to happen. So appreciate you taking the time, and recognize the city management and the comments that
just Mr. Mayor, also wanted to let the council know we are anticipating a dedication sometime, I think, in mid-October. I don't know if the date has been absolutely confirmed, but that will happen along the way, and we'll get a chance to all see it together firsthand and to celebrate with the business owners and the residents down in the area. So thank you, Joseph.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate you. We have a lot going on with the Children's Initiative, the Maureen Joy Charter. A lot is going on in that community, Habitat for Humanity. A lot is clicking on all cylinders there. So, but I appreciate y'all, and y'all have a blessed day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me ask the Councilwoman Cotati, item five that we pulled. You want to, and Councilman Moffitt.
I'm sorry. I'm lost the thread for a moment, but I have questions on item 12, and I don't think it got pulled previously.
Okay.
Thank you.
Five.
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to see if we could get a map of the phase two of the project, just for easier reference. And then I was struck by the MDBSE, and, well, the goals were so low. Can you comment on that? I think I'd have to pull up the memo, but it was 0 and maybe 2%.
I would have to, Reginald Johnson, Director of Department of Community Development.
Yes.
Those were reviewed by EOEA. I would have to talk further with them to get any more detail on them, but they did work with us on that.
Okay, it was 0 and 1% actually, so yeah, that'd be great. And then can you just comment on the management fee of 16%?
I would let Larry Jarvis, Assistant Director, comment on that.
Good afternoon, Larry Jarvis, Department of Community Development. The question was on the management fee. That goes back to the cap that the North Carolina Housing Finance Agency has on the developer's fee. And for McCormick Barron to earn the fee for this size project in North Carolina that they would have earned elsewhere in phase one, we allowed them to charge a management fee for their oversight of the site prep and the infrastructure and those types of things. And the same would be true with the second phase, where it's to equal things up in terms of the total developer's fee.
Thank you.
Just to be clear, too, that is a fee that would be paid to someone. We're just paying it to McCormick Barron. So it's not that it's an additional fee. It is a fee that would be paid to someone to manage the infrastructure design and installation on that phase of the project. Thank you.
Recognize Councilman. Had you finished, Councilman Cotardi? Let me go to Councilman Shule and then Councilman Marfitt.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. If we approve this, will we be able to meet the May and August deadlines described in here related to the tax credit application?
Yes, if we do approve it on this cycle, on this current cycle, we do have a schedule that will allow us to, McCormick Barron, to be in position to apply for the tax credits and have all of the work done and that's needed in time for the submission in May.
Okay. And then what uncertainties do we face in terms of the 4-acre site in this item? Any environmental concerns similar to phase one?
I don't think, and we don't think that there are going to be the concerns that we had with phase one. If you remember, there were studies done on phase one. The challenges that we had were after we went 20 feet in the ground, but the studies that we have done so far, we don't think that that's going to materialize again. If you remember, that was a particular ravine that was 20 feet in the ground.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Can I ask Councilman Marfitt?
Thank you. I have on page one, it's talking about the funding, and it says, let me move this note. There's repayable pre-development loan. Sometimes some of the loans that we do, we know in advance that they're going to roll over and probably not get repaid. Are we expecting full repayment of this particular loan?
The pre-development loan will be at 0% at the point at which we provide the other construction and permanent financing, and all the loans convert from the construction phase to the permanent phase. They all then will have an interest rate of 2%, except for that increment that we held back for the market rate units. And then it's subject to cash flow payments over the term, however we set the term up. And so there will be some repayment. It's not like a fully amortizing loan, but depending on how far we wanted to project out in the future, it would fully amortize. It might take 40 years or 45 years.
Okay. Then on page two, it's talking about a source of some of the funding or some of the work, east side of first block of South Roxborough, resignalization of the intersection, and it says the tasks were not completed or the funds expended. And I just wanted to ask, does that mean they were not expended for these tasks, or they were not expended in any way?
They were not expended for these particular tasks because they were concentrating on other issues that we were dealing with
right, on site at the time.
So it said that was not a priority, that we could hold that work back and complete it at a later date.
Okay. And then down at the bottom of page two, it talks about needing to make some commitments prior to determination of the award. Do we need to put the full $3.4 million at risk prior to determination of the award?
No, as a matter of fact, we can't enter into a full commitment until we have the award of tax credits.
Okay, great. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you. Recognize Councilman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just two questions. The you state that the phase one construction is moving towards a December 31, 2014, in-service date. How is that? Do you think we're going to meet that end of the year?
Yes, Councilmember Brown, I expect that we do. The first tenants will be moving in next month, moving into the buildings that are already complete. As we have shared earlier, there are buildings that are complete now. The building that will come online last will be building two, which is a four-story building on Lakewood. It is on schedule for completion in November. And so we do expect, and that's also with the pond, runs concurrently with that, and we do expect them to meet that schedule.
Second question, well, we hope we can meet that since, as you know, we were a year behind from 2013.
It will be met.
Second question, on this phase two that that we're talking about, that will be 79 units?
Yes, that's what we're looking at, 79 units.
And what will be, including all the costs that you have outlined here under the recommendation, what will be the aggregate cost per unit?
That don't.
Yeah, for those 79 units.
That I don't have the cost that you have in front of you, our pre-development cost. And one of the things that we do need to do is to engage firms to work on that. I don't know if Assistant Director Jarvis has any more comments on that at this point.
No, again, a part of the work that's subject to this particular item is finalizing the design of those buildings and the associated site prep and infrastructure costs, so we would be able to answer that question.
Okay, thank you.
Let's move to item seven, which was pool grant project ordinance recognized in 2014 State of Durham's economy breakfast revenues superseding ordinance 14325. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So the way I understand this, I just want to make sure, you want the State of Durham economy event to be self-sustaining and
yes.
then to put the remaining funds toward the Youth Works internships and neighborhood revitalization. Is that, did I get that right?
Sheila Huggins, Office of Economic and Workforce Development. Yes, so the breakout that you see on the grant shows how the money from the events will be spent.
Okay. And then so the ordinance has about $21,000 of the $64,000 in the 2014 event revenue going to the SODE expenses. And then does that mean that this will cover all event expenses for next year?
So let me make sure that you understand the $64,000 that's represented.
Obviously, I do not.
Okay.
So thank you.
Represents funds from both the 2012 event and the 2014 event. So
okay.
The amount that we have shown there, the $24,000, represents a portion received from last year and this year. And so we're not entirely sure that what we have in revenues this year will cover the next event.
I guess I'm. Okay, so I'm trying to figure out if it's self-sustaining or not. Is it, we're not sure.
So it is, we okay. did have profit. So at this point, we did cover all of our expenses,
okay.
yes.
Got it, thank you.
Listen, you're welcome. Move to item nine, a professional services contract, ST-272C, Duke Gregson Curve Extensions.
Yes, so the sole question I have is to what extent will the Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Commission be able to weigh in on the design of the curb extensions?
Good afternoon, Tasha Johnson, Assistant Director of Public Works. There are several public meetings scheduled throughout the design process, so there will be at least two opportunities for them to comment.
What I hope to avoid with Duke and Gregson is the current brouhaha that we're seeing over West Club. So, thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Move to item 10, contract with Biohabitats Inc. for Algus Turf Scroll Mobile Pilot System Installation Operation. Why are you moving? Why don't we get to Don's? You pulled 12. Okay. Why are you setting that up?
Let's see. Okay, so in this contract, there are two different bidders, and they have, and so what it looks to me like they're doing is that the water department's saying, we think that this is a representation of the work that we'll be calling these people to do on an emergency basis. And then you've applied you could correct me when I'm wrong here, but that you've applied their bids for each line item to this sort of overall comparison. And then the work may or may not be exactly like that. You may have more or less. Is that correct so far?
Yes, good afternoon, Mayor Pro Tem, members of council, Don Greeley, Department of Water Management. The units that are in there are typical units that would be used to pay for a contractor to doing emergency work. These contracts are in place with the intention of not being used. So hopefully, you know, we won't have an emergency that we'd have to call on them. The reason why we have two contractors is if one of the contractors has his forces tied up and, you know, we can call on another contractor.
There's a substantial difference in the two sort of overall pricing. Do you all go back and forth between them, or do you try to go to the lowest bid first on each contract? Or
we would probably go to the lowest bidder first, with the intention of, and if they weren't able to do the work, go to the second.
Thank you. Those are my questions.
Okay. Thank you. We can go to the presentation, item four.
Hello, my name is Danielle Meir. I'm with Public Works Department. And this is Michelle Wolfolk, also with the Public Works Department, who will answer other questions if I can't. I'm here today to present my agenda item requesting approval for the algal turf scrubber pilot study. So is there a way for us to meet the Falls and Jordan Lake goals in a cost-effective manner? The Falls and Jordan Lake strategies are to meet the state's chlorophyll A standard, which means less algae. Typical ways for us to reduce chlorophyll A levels, less algae, their plants, so is to reduce their food, which in this case would be nitrogen and phosphorus. This led to the state, the state had developed the lake nutrient strategies, and this requires the city of Durham to meet a target rate of 40% nitrogen reduction and 77% phosphorus reduction, leaving the land based on a 2006 levels. So there are some ways to reduce nitrogens from nutrient sources from the lake. One is in lake treatment. This is where nothing is disturbed. One example that most of you may have heard of on the news is the one that the North Carolina legislative approved in Jordan Lake, which is the solar bees. That pretty much aerates the lake and prevents harmful algal blooms. A second way would be lakeside treatment. This is where it pulls water out of the lake, treats it, and we pump it back in, also commonly known as the pump and treat. Dredging is another way people have reduced nitrogen and phosphorus from lakes. The sediment on the bottom has a lot of nutrients, so therefore if you remove the sediment, you're removing some of the nitrogen sources, which can then later be found up in the water column. So with this in mind, City of Durham had asked consultants to conduct a feasibility study on two innovative technologies that were lakeside treatment to determine if it would be cost effective. In order to evaluate new and innovative technology, there's a three-step process. First, there's a feasibility study, which is a pretty much a paper exercise to evaluate if these technologies will work in the city of Durham. Two were conducted and completed in 2013. Second phase would be the pilot study, which is the purpose of my agenda. Pilot study is a small-scale, short-term application of the technology in Durham. The pilot study will provide real-time data and information on how the technology will work in Durham's environment. Early troubleshooting would be, early troubleshooting of the process will also occur. This will give us a better idea to move forward with a full scale, which would be the third step. A full scale facility is larger, long term, and will provide us nutrient credits to meet our goals. So let me step back a second. I had mentioned we have completed a feasibility study. There were two of them. That's been completed in 2013. Early 2013, the City Council had approved these two studies, one on the algal turf scrubber and the second one on aqua lutions. The purpose of a feasibility study is, one, to find potential locations for a pilot study or a full-scale facility, disposal of byproducts or waste, to figure out the permits required for a pilot or a full-scale facility, the cost for a pilot study, and the cost for a full-scale facility. The algal turf scrubber feasibility study looked at how nutrients were removed since they grow algae, and then the algae's harvested and taken out of the lake, where Aqualutions removes the nutrients directly. Both of these studies focused on the Falls Lake watershed in Ellerby Creek, Little Lick Creek, and Falls Lake proper. So can this technology really work for Durham? Neither one of these technologies have been used nor evaluated in the city of Durham or North Carolina. So the study for the algal turf scrubber took city of Durham's stormwater monitoring data from Ellerby, Little Lick, and Falls Lake, put it in their model to determine the amount of algae that would grow and nutrients removed. And their results on this model study was very promising. There were assumptions made, such as what kind of algae will grow, the evaluation of like weather conditions, which would be the optimal algal growth and what would happen in our winters, and the amounts of nutrients that these algal mats would remove. The second feasibility study was the Aqualutions. Aqualutions technology for the feasibility had gone out, collected water samples from Little Lick, Ellerby, and Jordan Lake, I mean Falls Lake, I'm so sorry, and those samples, two were taken during the year, and they were sent to Florida to do a bench scale study. Currently, Public Works Stormwater is not recommending the Aqualutions technology at this time. Additional research is needed to determine its nutrient, its nitrogen removal. So to look at it and say, well, innovative new technology when we have old technology, you know, traditional technology such as BMPs, also known as SCMs, the stormwater control measures, one way of many different ways to compare the technologies is to do a cost per pound comparison, just looking strictly at the cost to remove pounds of nitrogen and pounds of phosphorus. This table here shows on the top is based on our feasibility study of the algal turf scrubber. The most efficient station, they estimated to be $19.67 per pound, and least efficient. On the bottom there, I have SCMs, the stormwater control measures. Those numbers were based on a 2010 Ellerby Creek watershed implementation plan, and that was based on the top 20 prioritized BMPs that we had written in that plan. Not on this chart is another one I know the committee's familiar with, is the South Ellerby wetland. You may want to know, how does the algal turf scrubber compare to that? Well, with the feasibility study, it looks like an algal turf scrubber, if the results were to show, can remove 2 to 3 times as much nitrogen and phosphorus as our South Ellerby Creek wetland. The estimated cost that the wetland would remove for nitrogen was $6,700, so that's tenfold higher than our least efficient estimate at the worst site for the feasibility. So I want to show you this pie chart real quick. This was created in April, May for a Public Works Stormwater budget meeting. We are stipulated by 2021 to meet our stage one development goals of nitrogen. As you see on this pie chart, we had put different BMPs, nutrient banks, existing projects, innovative technologies. You'll see it's a very small pie, piece of the pie, because we were very conservative and we don't have some of the studies produced. But this overall goal pie chart is about $45 million in order for us to meet stage one goals. Now, if we can get a pilot study to verify our results, we may be able to increase the innovative technologies. So based on our feasibility study, using our most cost-effective station, I'm going to show you the biggest picture, which would be 1,000% increase of innovative technologies in our strategy to meet our stage one nitrogen reduction goals. Now, some of us say, wow, you're using the most cost-effective from a estimated. Well, if I were to use the least cost-effective, the second line on my chart, we would still get an 80% increase in innovative technology as part of our plan to reduce nutrients and meet the state's goals. So there is a strong potential that the algal turf scrubber can be a big game changer. So why do a pilot study? First, the algal turf scrubber, as I said, can be a game changer to the overall city's plan to remove nitrogen to meet stage one Falls Lake nutrient strategy goals. Second, there are still several assumptions that need to be evaluated in North Carolina before considering a full-scale facility. The pilot study will verify assumptions made about performance and give us a closer look and better help us prepare our total budget and goal to meet our nutrient goals. So this agenda item asks for the approval of the algal turf scrubber pilot study, since the feasibility study showed promising results for nutrient reduction requirements. Thank you.
You're welcome. Let me see if there are questions by members of the council. I know one question is going to come up, so I'm going to ask it. It has nothing to do with the technology you talked about. It has to do with WDBE and employment. And I saw, is Deborah Giles in the audience? She's not here. Okay. I guess I was just curious in terms of the goals that were set, and maybe somebody could explain the goals, because the net of it is you have zero minority participation in this company. I think it's 3% for women, which met the goal. So I just thought maybe somebody on the staff could tell us what was behind that. I mean, given the fact that we raise this question now just about at every meeting.
Michelle Wolfolk with the Department of Public Works, and I can't answer that question, but we can get back with EOEA and find out the answer for that.
Appreciate it. Are there other questions on recognizing the Mayor Pro Tem?
I want to ask Michelle a question. Michelle, will we ever be able to reach the state goals?
Stage one or two?
Any of them. Just based on the fact that this is a man-made lake and it's a man or woman-made lake, what have you.
Human-made lake.
Any other definitions? Okay.
In my opinion, this is only my opinion, we can meet stage one. We cannot meet the chlorophyll A goal in the upper part of Falls Lake. In my opinion, I don't think the current strategy will cost us a lot of money and will not get us to the goal.
Okay. While you're standing, Michelle is an outstanding resource person for the Upper Neuse River Basin Board of Directors, and we just happened to meet yesterday. And I mentioned that we would receive a presentation on today from her, and she corrected me, and she in fact had to give the presentation yesterday for the Upper Neuse River Basin Board of Directors. And at one juncture I said, you are welcome to tune in to our work session, but they continued. Job well done.
Thank you.
Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Councilman Moffitt.
So are the nutrient removal statistics from the feasibility study, or are they from some other kind of modeling? that you're projecting. You're projecting these nutrient remove, this amount of nutrient removal, and then you're putting that into equation, and you're telling us what it's going to cost us. Where do the statistics come from? How much nutrients? Or where do the numbers come from? How much nutrients you think is going to remove?
Are you asking about the nutrients removed from algal turf scrubber, the most cost-effective and least? Well, there were about 10 stations that were evaluated based on flow conditions, and they have a model on how it would work. So we had the least effective, because it does need a flow, and there were some areas where they would not be able to get enough flow to remove the most, and then there were the best located areas. So all of that was put together on a model to create.
Okay, so it was from our own feasibility study that those numbers were.
No, these were produced from our location.
Yeah, that's what I want to know. Thank you very much.
Yeah, from ours. Thank you.
I can recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Okay, so first let me ask him, make sure I understand. I thought I did, and then I didn't. Now I'm not sure. The feasibility study was actually based on physical locations at Falls Lake. But when you say it was based on our locations, you're saying that we actually had something on the ground that we studied, or we took locations and put it into a computer model provided to us by algal turf scrubber?
We specified the locations in general that we wanted evaluated. Our monitoring program supplied information that went into a model, and then they evaluated 10 different locations with their model. Yes.
Right. Okay. Thanks. And the pilot study, somewhere around close to $400,000. And if we got to a full-scale facility, just out of curiosity, how much money are we talking about? Do we have any idea?
The feasibility study had estimated, depending on location and size, it was anywhere between $5 to $12 million, and that did not include the land. But then at the same time, a full scale will produce a lot more nutrient credits that we've already spoke to the state about.
Are there other questions? Recognize Councilman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Going back to my colleague's question about cost, you used the number, and I was a little confused, maybe, I'm sure it was my fault, but $45 million in your report, and that was to?
That was our estimate for stage one removal, yes.
Okay.
Just from stormwater.
I'm sorry?
Just from stormwater, because there's also.
That's just with the stormwater.
Yes.
Okay. So with the more efficient model, what would that cost be? Or estimate? I know these are all estimates.
Best case, we could potentially half that.
Okay. Well, see, to some, that may raise the specter, the issue of why so much emphasis on stormwater removal that can be exceedingly costly to any development if it's not that efficient.
A legitimate question for the state. Right now, we have a mandate,
yeah.
So we're working on the mandate. We are also working on trying to modify the mandate to something more realistic, but that's still a few years away.
But then the final question is, be it $20 million or $45 million, where's the money going to come from?
From the citizens of the watershed.
Does that include those in Wake County?
A small number. Very small number.
Okay, so what, in conclusion, what you're telling us is that cost will be borne by most of the people here this afternoon, meaning the taxpayers of Durham City and Durham County.
Based on what we know now, yes. We are, of course, with this innovative technology, there's opportunities to do true public-private partnerships. There's opportunities to work with nutrient banks who may look at this as an easier way to generate credits to be sold. But we are, that's step three and slightly beyond.
we're still at the pilot study phase.
Mr. Manager, I would like in the future, some within hopefully the next several months, to have a report on the entire credit approach to environmental issues. And I know that's what Duke is looking at in terms
of. We are in discussion of that. I don't know that it will be ready in a couple of months, but as soon as it's ready,
whenever,
we'll bring it back to the council. Ready. Absolutely.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Are there other questions? If not, thank you for the presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I did want to comment that it's amazing how many people came out to hear this presentation on the Falls Lake nutrient reduction, and I want to thank people for their interest.
Yes. Thank
well,
you.
Steve,
well, especially too, since they're going to be paying for it.
The manager just commented this is the largest stormwater presentation crowd we've had, so he's right in line with you. Wow. So if those who are here to hear the presentation, that's over. You're here for something else, I guess we can go to something else, which is item 4, and it's the city manager's response to the Durham Human Relations Commission and Civilian Police Review Board. Let me say this before the manager starts again, because I just want to make sure we're clear. The council just received this report Monday night after city council meeting, 131 pages. I haven't been through all of it. Some of my colleagues may have. I have not gone through all of it. So what we want to do this evening is to allow the city manager to present his report. If there are questions that council members have, allow time for that. Those of you in the audience who have signed up to speak, and I want to make sure that I have 16 persons, so if anyone else wants to speak, I suggest you go to the table now, because after the 16th person, that's going to be it. This is not a public hearing, but we understand the interest, and that's why we're allowing persons to speak. If you have written comments, you can leave them with the clerk. Based on the number of people we have signed up, I'm going to suggest that each person has no more than 3 minutes to speak on an item. And as I said, if you have written comments, you can leave it with the clerk. What we will do after we've heard the comments, after we've heard the city manager's report, it will allow the council to go back and digest what has been said. And this item would be on the September 2nd city council meeting as a GBA item, general business agenda item, which time the council will react, or may choose not to react to what's been said and what's been heard. So that's the process we're going to use, and I'm going to turn it over to the city manager. And again, if you want to speak, please go to the clerk's office, clerk's desk, and sign up for this item. All right, Mr. Manager, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good afternoon again, everyone. Mayor and members of council, as you recall, at the June 16th city council meeting, I reiterated to you and the public my commitment that the city manager's and the city manager's office commitment to lead the review and subsequent response to the recommendations regarding police community relations, racial bias and disparity from the Human Relations Commission, as well as the recommendations and the related recommendations from the Civilian Police Review Board, with the goal of completing our work and reporting back to the City Council at today's work session. And I'm pleased, as a result of a team effort, focused commitment of time and resources over the last 60 days this summer, we are able to meet that goal and are here today to discuss the report, which, as you mentioned, Mr. Mayor, was provided to you and the community earlier this week on Monday afternoon. And while the process has been long and at times arduous, it has not been a burden. In fact, I can safely speak for my staff that we have learned a lot along the way, and while some perspectives have been confirmed, many new ones have been shaped. Let me first begin with a few thank yous to my city manager office staff, Wanda Page, Keith Chadwell, Bo Ferguson, Beverly Thompson, Carmisha Wallace, and our ICMA fellow, Maddie Stevens, who were major and significant contributors to the report. I want to give them recognition as well. Again, as I had indicated earlier to the mayor and city council, I want to thank you for your patience in allowing the process and the review of the processes to run their course without intervention, and trusting the staff to do the work that you charged us with. I want to thank Deputy Chief Anthony Marsh as the Durham Police Department's liaison to the city manager's office to assist in responding to questions we had about current police practices and general orders. Certainly, again, thank you to the Human Relations Commission and the Civilian Police Review Board for the countless hours you've spent over the last 10 months thinking about these issues, shaping issues, and helping us to think about them as well. And finally, I'd like to thank the advocacy groups for your input, and more importantly, for your cooperative attitude that you presented to us on behalf of your organizations when we had the opportunity to meet with you. Durham's greatness is enhanced by its willingness to publicly discuss and debate difficult issues and difference of thought and opinion. And this issue of police community relations and unexplained racial disparities are no different. Here are some of the takeaways from our work. First, we have a great and dedicated and nationally recognized police department and staffed by men and women who are committed to public safety, a consistent high priority from our resident satisfaction survey. We found in numerous areas the recommendations were either already in practice or were in the process of being responded to. The police department's data and analytics practices are some of the best in the state, if not in the country. The police department needs to better and proactively use these capabilities to inform the command staff and the city administration when trends indicate inequities or issues that negatively impact positive police community relations. Our review and the data tells us in some areas unexplained racial disparities do exist, and we need to use these data capabilities to better understand and explain trends and underlying specifics of disparities and respond to what we learn and discover. We need to do all of this proactively at the highest levels, as regular and a routine part of our work. And finally, to be effective, many of the issues at hand regarding disparities and community relations extend well beyond the boundaries of the Durham Police Department. Many meeting Durham's community standards, expectations, and aspirations regarding safety, justice, and equity will take a dialogue and collaboration between the entirety of the local criminal justice system. The City of Durham and its Police Department, Durham County Sheriff's Office, the District Attorney's Office, the District Court, and many others. The report and recommendations therein stand on their own, and I'm certainly prepared to clarify, answer, and respond to questions from the City Council as you deem appropriate this afternoon. As we have worked through this process, the resounding themes of trust, accountability, and transparency were clear and are evidently critical to moving forward, and we are committed to see that they remain so. As it relates to transparency, it is my intention that the recommendations, once confirmed, will be tracked and our progress transparent to the community through the city's website, through periodic PAC updates, and other community presentations. I am certain that some will never be satisfied with the level of transparency, but privacy laws and security will prevail. As it relates to accountability, from the city manager to the police chief, the police department, and the entire city organization, we expect to be held accountable to the mayor and city council and the community for our work and our actions, and most importantly, for our results. No one is perfect, and while we may strive for perfection, we expect excellence in everything we do as employees of this organization. And finally, as it relates to trust, the public trust is an awesome responsibility, none more important than a trust a community has with its police department. Trust between the police department and all segments of the community is in every resident's best interest, and it is essential for a civil society and a progressive city. And while trust must certainly be earned, it equally must be given. And I look forward to using this report and the resulting discussions to strengthen the bridge connecting this trust. So thank you this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Let me ask first, are there questions or comments by members of the council? I recognize Councilman Moffitt. Do you have the mayor pro tem?
I just want to add my appreciation for the both to FADE, Fostering Alternatives to Drug Enforcement, for bringing these issues forward in the first place and really putting them, bringing them really to our attention, and secondly to the Human Relations Commission for their many months of work, many meetings, hearing both presentations and personal experiences, and for compiling that into the report. I just wanted to give that credit as well.
Thank you. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do have some questions, but first I wanted to thank the city manager and your office, Mr. Bonfield. This was a prodigious amount of work produced in a short period of time, and I think that you all covered a lot of ground. And I also wanted to thank the city attorney's office for your participation, Mr. Baker. I think that was really valuable, and the information that you included here about the legal precedents and so forth was extremely helpful. Thank you. But I really appreciated, I think this lays a great groundwork for our discussion, and I really very much appreciate it. It's extremely thoughtful. And to, again, to the Human Relations Commission, others have said it, but you all did a great job. I know many of you all are here today. I wanted to say to our police department, I know this isn't, going through this whole process has been trying. Our officers are over here on this side, our leaders, and I just want to say that we have a lot of confidence in you, and we know that we have tremendous men and women on the street doing a great job. And I've been riding with police officers lately, young officers, late at night, and seeing firsthand the work that they do and the difficult decisions that they have to make all the time. And it's impressive. They're thoughtful. They're well educated, and they're doing their best every day. So thank you all for leading that kind of force. So I have some questions, let me just think what I'll do is I'll just sort of, first of all, I want to say some of the things that I want to commend the police department for in terms of what this report told us. One of them is I was really pleased to see the proactive response you all have made on the recommendation concerning the training that you all have instituted in bias-based policing. I think that this is a great step forward. I know you all were already involved in this, but the fact that you've resolved to strengthen this and to have all your new officers go through it and your current staff is great. Also noticed there was a recommendation in there for the possibility of other members of the community joining the top leadership in that kind of session. And I just wanted to say I also thought that was a great idea. And in general, I wanted to thank you and commend you for moving forward on that. That was a key recommendation, I think. And I think you've taken the bull by the horns. I was also really impressed, something I knew about, but this report really strengthened it for me, which was the extent to which our crisis intervention training is extremely well developed. And the fact that we have 180 officers who've had this training, the fact that many of them are line officers, is also a real tribute to what you do. Your alliance with behavioral health and the fact that we have a specialized staff who's helping with that relationship. And again, that's something I've seen many times when I've been riding, is the importance of that training. And again, I want to thank you and commend you. And then finally, practices that you've already adopted regarding data collection, which Mr. Bonfield outlined here. You've already taken a lot of really strong steps to improve the data collection and the accountability that goes along with that. I want to thank you all for those steps, and I think that they're extremely commendable. And it says to me that our police department has really been listening, and I'm really appreciative of that. There are more things, but those were a few of the highlights for me that I thought that I really wanted to say to the department how important they were and how good. I have a lot of questions, but the ones that I want to focus on are really having to do with the cameras, the consent search. But I think before I get to them, I want to make just one general comment about the marijuana, having the low-level drug enforcement be, that drug enforcement for low-level violations be our lowest priority, which was a recommendation of some of the groups and the Human Relations Commission has dealt with as well. And what I want to say about that is I think it's really important, but I'm extremely supportive of what the manager had to say about that, which is that this is a community-wide. This cannot be done by our police department alone. It can't be done just by change in enforcement. That's got to be part of it. And I was, I thought that there was a, I'm sure many of you all are aware of an article that Ray Gronberg did in the Herald not long ago, which talked about the fact that Durham already has, our drug arrests are already substantially below the national and state average. They are perhaps, I believe, four times lower than other cities in North Carolina, including Winston-Salem. This is really, this was new information and good. And so I believe very deeply that mass incarceration of young African-American men is one of the greatest, if not the greatest, challenge facing our society, and I believe very deeply that this has to do with low-level drug offenses and the way that they are dealt with here in Durham and elsewhere, and I think we need to change it. But what I do feel very strongly is it's going to take a discussion with the district attorney and with our judges, and so I think the manager recommended, is, if I read this correctly, that we move forward with that and that we, that the council try to initiate that. Mr. Bonfield, is that a correct interpretation? And that we move forward with that and we get that discussion going so that we can make that happen. I don't think that's something we can make happen by ourselves, but I feel as a council it should be our obligation, and I appreciate the manager bringing to us that we need to push this. And I believe that, and I think we need to get together with our district attorney, and we need to get together with our judges, and we need to make this happen. I wish personally that we could decriminalize marijuana possession, but that's not going to happen in this state, and so we have to deprioritize, and we need to work with our police in the way that will work for them, and we'll work with our judges and our district attorney. The area of the report that I was most concerned about has to do with the consent searches and the cameras, and I'm sorry that I will try to be organized, and I'm not sure I can be, actually, on this, but let me just take it from the top, maybe starting to talk about the cameras, since I think they come first, and this is about recommendation 6 and 7. I know that we're not going to answer all these questions today, but let me just tell you what mine are. I was concerned that, well, I let me just say that I felt that it would be a good thing if, or at least would worthy of study, that the officer would be required to activate the camera when he or she gets out of the car to encounter a suspect, if this was not a traffic stop. So we have, if the light is already running, as I understand it, the camera's on. But I also, I assume that there are times when that is not true, and I think we're looking for situations as often as we can to get the camera on. And I was impressed with what you included about the body cameras and the fact that they have the potential to reduce the use of force and other problems substantially, and the fact that we're looking at the body cameras I think is great. But I wasn't entirely satisfied with the idea that the cameras were going to be on so intermittently, and I was troubled by that. And I felt like we needed a firmer guideline, you know, prohibit turning the camera off until such and such a time. So, do you want to?
Well, I'd like the staff who worked on that issue maybe to comment. But,
sure.
Mr. Ferguson.
Bo Ferguson, Deputy City Manager for Operations. worked with Deputy Chief Marsh on responding to that. The current practice, and Deputy Chief, I encourage you to correct me if I misstate this, is that for traffic stops, It does capture those in instances where they get away from the car. There is a radio on the officer, and where the when they get out of range of the car, that's where it becomes problematic for it to capture. I think that's where some of the discussion of the body cameras was mentioned as a potential technological fix, but you are correct that they are not able to capture all interactions at this point with civilians.
And that's more of a technology issue than it is something that is overt decision on the part of the officer not to do.
That's correct. Whenever a vehicle-initiated interaction is there and the cameras are mounted on the vehicle, the cameras are running throughout that interaction, and it's part of the general order that they must remain in operation throughout that interaction. It is when they get away from the vehicle that the microphone is no longer able to capture.
Okay, so, I mean, I have some more specifics about that, but let me just say that I think what I really want to do is flag it and just say, I don't want to try to go into a lot of detail here, but I found it, and maybe it is all just technological and can't be solved, but I had this sense that my feeling was we needed some sort of a firmer guideline, that we were, you know, officers, that would give the officers the ability to use the camera, and that, in fact, we would insist upon the use of the camera as much as possible. I'm not sure, I'm sure I don't have all the details, but I'd like to understand it better. Maybe
we'll certainly flag that and go back and see if there's language that needs to be clarified or additional information that can be provided.
Thank you very much. My other issue, and this is, I think, is the most significant issue, is how to handle the consent stops, the consent searches. And I understand very, very, very well why the police officers really want the discretion to make the decisions that they, you know, on a timely basis when they're there and in a situation. And as I say, I've been riding with police who've been in difficult situations and have had to make very tough, timely decisions, and where discretion was important. I don't understand why this would have to be one of them. I can very well see why, you know, the difficulties that were described here, an officer would have to go back to his car perhaps, or her car, and retrieve the form, would have to come forward with that form, is concerned about losing control of the stop. Those are legitimate concerns, and then I think we have to weigh them against the fact that discretion is traded for the fact that you've got a written consent and that you know the person is really truly fully consented. If we had the kind of camera coverage that we're talking about, where we really did have body cameras that were truly recording the situation and we knew we could rely on that, I think I would feel differently. But since we don't have that, my concern is that we have a really solid knowledge that consent has been given, and I think the way to do that is written consent. I was also impressed by the fact that in the report it says most agencies and even the Durham District Attorney and Chief District Court Judge indicate their preference for documented searches. That's important. The fact that our judges, the Chief District Court Judge and the District Attorney favor that, and we can't fully document with the cameras, what is our other option? Our other option is written consent. And so I just hope that we will give that every consideration. I would very much hope that we would adopt that. I do understand that it is not free of cost for our police officers, but I hope we'll go in that direction. I will note that the report says that officers will be encouraged to employ the written consent to search form. However, the discretion will remain with the officer. And the encouragement is good. I know that matters. You know, if that's your training and you're encouraged to do it, I've seen our police officers to know enough that will make a difference. But I think we can put the nail in this, and I think we should. I was hopeful, I guess one other thing I'd like to flag in that regard is a little bit more about the Fayetteville experience with the consent searches, with the writ consent searches. I think I'm going to leave it at that, Mr. Manager. I have quite a few other questions of a sort of smaller nature, but those I think are, to me, the big unanswered ones. They especially have to do with the cameras and the consent searches, and then exactly how you've set the table for us in terms of working with our judges and our district attorney to try to deal with the low-level drug arrests. And I think it's up to us to take that on and to get on with it. So thank you so much, Mr.
Thank you, Councilman Shule. Are the other recognized, the Mayor Pro Tem and Councilman Davis?
Mrs. Shule covered a lot of what I was.
Just a minute, Mayor Pro Tem.
I
hope that you have patience with us. This report was to the council from the city manager, and so that's why I'm allowing the council persons to ask questions as they seem necessary. But we're going to get to the public comments also, so just bear with us. But I'm just trying to follow what we set up, and we asked the manager to make a report. He's made the report, and there's an opportunity for the council members to raise their questions.
I'll just be brief then. First of all, I want to thank the Human Relations Commission for taking on this project. You spent countless numbers of hours listening to our citizens, and I am so glad that the citizens came to us and shared all of the concerns that you had. Otherwise, we might never have known all of the details of what was going on in the community. And thirdly, let me thank you for coming here today. And I am anxiously awaiting to hear from those who signed up. I share some of the concerns that Mr. Shule stated, but my greatest concern is with the greatest concern that the citizens shared, and that had to do with consent searches as well. And so I want to get more details from that later, Mr. Manager. But one of my major questions is, who are we recruiting? That's not a part of this study, but we need to look at who we are recruiting, where they're coming from, and then we need to look at the content of our orientation so that the people who come to work for us understand that this is local government. It is not an arm of the military. It is local government, and they are here to protect our citizens. So I think we need to look into the content of orientation to make sure early on when they hit Durham soil that they understand who they're working for. I haven't had a chance to go to orientation. I do plan to do that. But it's so important that at that first step, you know who you're coming to work for and the demographics and culture of this city. That's basically where I am right now. I have a lot of questions, but I also want to hear from our citizens. But we need to look at recruitment. We need to look at the orientation content to make sure that people who come to work for us better understand who we are and what our expectations are. Now, Chief, I give you credit. At the last graduation, you shared a new light for me on what the expectations were for folk who came into the city as police officers to work for us. I appreciate that. But what I want to see is their first day on the job doing orientation, they understand who we are, because after they finish the academy, they may have already got, you know, formed some opinions. And so I want at the beginning, and I can't tell you what to do, but I can share what would be great. If you could speak to them day on what the expectations are. You don't tarnish, a badge tarnishes, and you can clean it up. But when you tarnish a reputation, it's not that easy. And the importance of trust between the community and our officers. Thank you.
I recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to follow up on all the things that my colleagues have said and to thank the manager for his wide reach in terms of trying to make sure that he got comments from all segments of the community. I'm particularly thankful that you reached out to members of the clergy and trying to make sure that houses of faith are able to weigh in on these issues and that we can have hopefully a community dialogue that would include the clergy, the community, the schools, and the home to make sure that our children are aware of the things that, in addition to the things that you've had in specifically from the HRC Commission, but also that we have a community dialogue talking about the issues that face our children, particularly in light of the things that we've been watching from the Midwest and in other parts of this country. Durham can lead, and we have the people, as evidenced by the folks who are here today, and I'm hoping that we can have a widespread community dialogue about the issues that have come forth from the manager's report, from the HCR commission, I'm sorry, HCR, as well as from other people who want to make sure that we make sure that we don't have the kinds of things that would happen here that have happened in other places. So I commend you and want to hear from the people. Thank you.
Councilman Davis. Councilwoman Cotardi.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor, and thank you all for coming. I will just make some very broad general remarks. I did have specific questions, but in trying to collate them just now, I realized this is not a page number document, and I think I've just moved them all out of order. So I just want to start by saying how much I really appreciate the careful review and the analysis, and of course, all the community input. I do look forward to a much more in-depth discussion and additional review. I will say that I was very comforted by the, through the analysis, that so much of the recommendations already meet best practices elsewhere in the country and I do, and in the state, and that we have begun to implement some of the recommendations. In terms of specifics, well, I should say, Mr. Manager, can you reissue this with page numbers? That would be good for the next round, and I'll just transpose them. Thank you. In terms of the consent searches, so really around recommendations 9, 10, and 11, I wanted to get a better understanding of why just the heat teams would be doing audio and video recording. So again, trying to get a better handle on that. I'd also like to know, in terms of making the use of cameras and microphones mandatory for cars that are so equipped, what proportion of our current force already has that equipment? So how broad is that? Let me jump. In terms of, I don't know which recommendation this is because my page is now out of order, but in terms of semi-annual analysis of data on traffic stops, I'd like an understanding on why you didn't suggest we do it quarterly. I didn't see that specifically. Sure. Yeah, help
so,
me
so
find
the
my
recommendation
next
was quarterly, and mm-hmm. when we reviewed that, we really felt like quarterly is not going to give you enough information to identify trends in that regard, and it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
You know, and so we felt that it was more realistic, and we could get as much out of the data that would come out of a semi-annual report. Still doesn't mean that things aren't being reviewed, you know, on an incident basis or something like that, but in terms of the totality of the data, it was a much more efficient use of time and more likely to be, you know, more meaningful information if it had a larger context, and semi-annual would do that.
Okay, thank you, I appreciate that. In terms of again, I don't have the recommendation number, but the implementation of fair and impartial policing, and I do appreciate that you have already begun implementation, and you do spell out a training schedule both for new recruits and for captains and lieutenants and others, and I was essentially trying to get a handle on when we expect everyone that's planned to be trained would be trained. So what's the end timetable on that?
I need to ask Deputy Chief Marsh if he could give that estimate. Mr. Chadwell is over at the county assisting in a recruitment interviews, but Anthony.
Good afternoon, Council. Deputy Chief Anthony Marsh, Operations Support. October 1st and 2nd, the exec staff and the captains and lieutenants will receive their training. We sent two people to Connecticut to be trained as trainers. We just sent two other officers down to Fayetteville recently to be trained as trainers. They've come back. The last group of recruits that just graduated, they just completed this training before reporting for duty. In terms of getting the entire department on training, on a training schedule, that's going to take several months. It's just a matter of scheduling, that's all.
And that's something that we will be building into our tracking system and continuing to report.
Actually, going forward, the plan is to have every single Durham police officer trained and every recruit after they graduate going forward will also receive this training. We put it at the end because we want it to be fresh in their minds when they hit the street interacting with the public.
And on that note, I also appreciate the rationale on the CIT training that you would wait.
Yes, ma'am.
So
thank you, Chief.
I don't know where that is. Thank you. In terms of, sorry, I believe this is mental health training. Give me one sec. Yeah, for crisis intervention, you did talk about looking to secure new resources, so I guess at some point it'd be helpful to understand what the estimated cost or what you believe the need is. Okay, let's see what else. And I think the quarterly review was number 17 that I already did. So in terms of making marijuana arrests a low priority, I very much support the ongoing collaboration and meeting of both the chief, the sheriff's department, the district attorney, and district court. I think that's very important. I did see, I believe, that you would recommend reporting back to the Durham Crime Cabinet, and my request would be that invitation for that go to all city council and all county commissioners, not just those that serve on the Crime Cabinet. And I guess at some point I'd like interim briefings or sense of what the likelihood of consensus is among that group and what kind of, if we need more of a political dialogue or community dialogue, so to speak, that would be really helpful to know what that group is thinking. And that might be it until I sort through. Thank you. Again, I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, thank you. I didn't know how to tackle this report except from the beginning, and so I'm up to about, and just to read it as carefully as I can and make as many notes as possible, so I'm up to about item 16. I'm counting on having a time in the future when we can come back and discuss this more fully, sort of all of us, so thank you.
Recognize the mayor pro tem.
Yeah, I wasn't going to ask this, but I want. How often are officers rotated out of stressful circumstances? This is from recommendation 5. We recommend psychiatric evaluations for all officers and employees, required once every 3 years. And it states here, and there isn't a page, this HRC 5. Right. Yeah. So personnel exposed to extreme and stressful circumstances for many years. That in, that means folk who are working in stressful districts or maybe in the military and
There is a general order that's attached to the, there's an attachment to recommendation, and that has the specifics of which positions are in those, that stressful environment. It doesn't have anything to do with the you know, previous experience type things. But we can certainly give you more information offline, but the details of which positions are covered are in the backup material.
Okay. I thought we might want to look at other kinds of professions that might cause stress as well, because that could be transferred to law enforcement.
Okay, are there other comments by members of the council before we go to the public? If not, what I will do is to call each name. If you can come to the podium to my right, we have a timer. We're going to use 3 minutes per speaker. Again, if you have written material you'd like to leave with the clerk, feel free to do that. So as I call your name, if you could just come to the podium again, state your name and address. Ian Mance. Minister Rafid Zahid. Charlie Reese. Victor Bynum. Howard Matchinger. Phil Wiggins. Stella Adams. Chris Tiffany. Mark Anthony Middleton, Mike Evans, Jesse Gibson, Roland Staten, Jackie Wagstaff, Nancy Wilson, DeCarlo Stanley, and Phil C. Now, is there anyone else that wants to speak whose name I did not call? If you, again, if you go to the podium and sign up, please. After I get the last card from the clerk, that will be the last person to speak on this item. So please, if you think you want to speak, go to the clerk's station and sign up. Are you Mr. Mance? You will proceed, please. Sure.
My name is Ian Mance. I'm an attorney at the Southern Coalition for Social Justice. I'm also a member of the FADE Coalition. Our address is 1415 West NC Highway 54. I want to say, since we only have limited time, that I am in support of all five of the FADE recommendations, and we have said from the beginning that we think all five are necessary in order to see the sort of systemic change that we're looking for here in Durham. But since we have limited time, I want to say a few words about written consent. A few weeks ago, I provided each member of the council and Mr. Mayor with a copy of a number of memorandums that explore the different reasons why written consent makes sense from a racial equity perspective, how it's proven effective in other jurisdictions in reducing the sort of racial disparities that we see in Durham, which are very pronounced and which are among some of the worst in the state. It also lays out the case why written consent makes sense from a law enforcement perspective. As Councilman Shule mentioned, and I appreciate his remarks, if you go and talk to the prosecutors in the district attorney's office, many of them will tell you that they are wholly in support of this policy. I also provided you with a memorandum from the University of North Carolina School of Government, which lays out your inherent authority as a city council to implement written consent. And we also provided you a memo on the marijuana LLEP, laying out your authority to do that as well. I want to say that I believe that the city manager's recent changes and general orders represent positive developments. But if making a significant reduction in the racial disparities that we see in traffic enforcement and the warrantless searches is our goal, and I believe that it is, then the solutions that he's proposed are not going to be sufficient. The policy changes for the home searches and for the heat teams, I think, are a good one, and I think it's the home one is particularly wise in light of the recent story about the 911 entry that the Independent Weekly broke. But it's not going to make a difference in the lives or in most citizen police interactions, because those happen in the context of vehicle stops. So I just wanted to reiterate that there is reason to think that a written consent policy for patrol officers would make a significant difference in those disparities, and the memos kind of lay those out. Ultimately, if what we want is this measurable reduction, I would also stress that it's important that we do written consent and not recorded consent, as some have suggested and some departments have done. The reasons for this are very detailed, and I don't have time to go into them now. I would direct you to an excellent 2002 Michigan Law Review article called Erasing the Fourth Amendment that I'd be happy to provide you, that really gets into the racial dynamics at play during citizen police encounters and the different way that white and black citizens are socialized to deal and interact with the police. Our district attorney supports this, our new district attorney, Roger Eccles. I've spoken to him about it. He has expressed his support. The community organizations here today, can the P, is that 3 minutes? Sorry, okay.
Again, if you have a written report, you can leave it with the clerk, your remarks.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, can I make a quick comment?
Sure.
I'd like to, if you could send the article you mentioned to all the council members, that'd be very beneficial, I think.
I will.
I certainly don't anticipate that I will want to respond to every comment that's made, but if something is said, putting words in my mouth that need to be clarified, I'd like an opportunity to clarify that on the record so that people don't misconstrue. And to go back to the report and the conversations that I had personally with Roger Eccles and with Judge Morey and others, their preference is documented consent, was not written consent. The report says documented consent. It doesn't say written consent. Okay. I don't know what your conversations were. Yeah. I'm not asking you to debate. I just want to be sure for the record. And then also wanted to be clear that the charge from the council was that we respond to the recommendations from the HRC and the Civilian Police Review Board. It was not that we respond to the requests or, you know, the suggestions from FADE. Nothing against the organization, but there was a distinction between those, and I think that needs to be said for the record. And finally, the city attorney may want to comment about the information that was provided from the North Carolina School of Government on those issues, but there's some question about, you know, the ease of which that communication was provided. I hope I don't have to say anything the rest of the afternoon, but I did. Those things were important as we start. Thank you.
Mr. Attorney, you have any comments?
No.
Okay. All right, thank you. Again, if you want to leave your remarks with the clerk, appreciate it. Next is Minister Rafid Saeed.
Yes, good afternoon, council members, city attorney. I'm gonna be real brief because I think, my name is Minister Rafiq Zaidi. I'm a senior citizen, 71 years old. I reside at 807 South Duke Street, J.J. Henderson. As the president of the Black Concerned Citizen and a member of FADE, I believe that Mr. Mance, Attorney Mance, have really explained what I was intending to say. And as I read this agenda, the items today as I came into this building, I noticed that number three, it had a resource person by the name of Bo Ferguson. And I thought that was real strange because the name Ferguson should ring a bell. And you know, I'm from the Show Me State, Missouri. And I believe that if accepted in grace, with trust and transparency, to heal this city, if those five recommendations was accepted, like the marijuana in Seattle, of course, there was white boys using marijuana in Seattle. They were being suspended from school. They were being incarcerated. There was lawyers, doctors, and judges. So they had to come up with a law to protect their own kind. That's what happened in Seattle, from the horse's mouth. But I'm here to let you know that we have a fight here in front of us. And our fight, my fight, is to give our children's life a long longevity. We have been people classified as non-white who have been considered targets in this community. I need to go no further, Jerkerson, Ferguson. But I pray that all of us will use this time that we have in our lives to do the best that we can in service to all our community, our towns and our cities, and to our nation. And let us make the world in which we live better on our leaving than the world that we found as we came in our berth. And in my conclusion, I had a meeting last night. Not going to tell you where it's at, because you're kicking the door. With some young black brothers. And they said to me, he said, Brother Zadie, we're going to have a protest like Ferguson. And we're going to start it at the DPAC. We planned on holding it when Bill Crosby come to town. I said, no, that's what they want. They want an excuse to use those military weapons that they have brought in the city to kill you. So I ask you, I beg of you, do something now, or we all going to pay a price for not doing anything at all.
Thank you. Charlie Reese.
Good afternoon. My name is Charlie Reese. I'm a resident of Durham. I live at 3604 Darwin Road, and I'm here today on behalf of Durham People's Alliance. The city manager's report, though well-researched and well-intentioned, falls short of what the people of Durham need from our city's leaders on this critical issue of restoring public trust in the Durham Police Department. The measures proposed by the city manager today simply will not do enough to eliminate the troubling racial disparities that exist in the enforcement practices of the Durham Police Department. Disparities that have been brought forward by the FADE Coalition and the Human Relations Commission, disparities that diminish us greatly as a community. I do want to recognize the months of hard work that city employees put in for this report, the city manager, the city attorney, and the rest of the staff. I also want to thank the members of the city manager and his staff for meeting with representatives from the People's Alliance to discuss these important issues. I believe that Tom Bonfield is a dedicated public servant who wants what is best for Durham. And there are certainly a number of positive steps in this report, as Ian Mance mentioned before, the racial equity training for officers, the periodic review of officer stop data, the increased use of audio and video recording by patrol officers and the heat teams, and the written consent for consensual home searches. But perhaps the most disappointing failure in this report is the city manager's decision not to require written consent for consensual vehicle searches. You know, our police officers are a true asset in our community. They do a difficult job well. And nobody wants them to be in more danger than is absolutely necessary. But even if there is, assuming that the city manager is right, even if there is some increment of additional risk to officers in asking them to obtain a written consent for a consensual vehicle search, as Councilman Shewell said, you have to compare that to the very real harm that's happening right now today in the city of Durham, the harm that's being caused by these racial disparities in the way that vehicles are searched in Durham. And as Councilman Shewell said, that's a cost we should be willing to pay in order to address these very troubling disparities. That's why the Durham People's Alliance continues to stand with the FADE Coalition and urging the City Council to take the next step in this process, to continue to ask the difficult questions that you've asked today about the recommendations made by the City Manager, and to adopt the remaining recommendations that have been put forward by the FADE Coalition. Durham People's Alliance is confident that these recommendations will make the Durham Police Department a better partner in the life of our community, and will reaffirm that all of Durham's citizens are entitled to equal protection of the laws. Thank you.
Victor Bynum.
Good evening, everyone. I'm from Madrigal Terrace. I don't really want to give my address. Police there all the time. They're not in Woodcroft. That's why I came here. I feel safer in Woodcroft. Even though the police are in Madrigal Terrace all the time, and I believe that police are supposed to be in a place where you feel safe, and I don't feel safe around the police, so that's the opposite of what they're supposed to be doing. I have 3 minutes. I didn't write anything down. I am the youngest one here. I am representing right now. Another thing I needed to say was that suspects here seem to be only black folk, and white people are also suspects too, because contraband is actually found equally amongst all races, but they are not persecuted like everyone has them on it. So everyone does dirt, but everyone isn't searched for their dirt. And that's another thing I need to say. If I can get anybody who is here who believes that we have racial disparities amongst the police. If you can just raise your hand so we can see that visually, this is no joke. I'm not here just, you know, for no reason. I had to pay my way here, and freedom is supposed to be free, but I had to pay my way, as in gas, as in time to take off of work, because that's where I come from. And so if you don't know me, you do know me now, and you will continue to know me, because I won't stop until you guys stop. I have 1 minute. I didn't know it was going to go this slow, but I can keep speaking because it's a problem I've been dealing with since I was born. And let's see, what else? You guys say anything and I'll expand on it for a minute.
No, there's no yielding time. Everybody has 3 minutes.
Just give me something, anything. I forgot what I was going to say when I got up here. Every 28 hours, a black man is killed or by the police. And that is more than people who are in a war zone overseas. And that's ridiculous. It seems that we're at a war over here, but people are trying to blind our eyes like we're not seeing what we are really seeing. So all I'm asking, oh, I just remembered something. I see a lot of construction going up, but where I don't see it is in the MAC, where I've been there for a long time, and I haven't seen any buildings. I haven't seen any, hold on guys. I haven't seen any type of, you know, community organizations there. I'm there, I'm willing to go into the East. I'm around there too, and all the places where police are patrolling regularly every day, on the hour, every hour. That's where I'm not seeing a lot of progression. So I've seen South Point go up, and I just think we need more buildings. So call on me if you need any help. Thank you.
You're welcome. Howard Messinger.
Good afternoon. I'm Howard Machtinger. I'm a Durham resident. And while I appreciate, I'm a member, a proud member of the FADE Coalition, and while I appreciate all the appreciation given us, I'm disturbed by what not, was not heard in our reports. And let me remind us that the Ferguson incident began, according to the testimony of a witness, with the police cussing at two young black men walking down the street. Do any of us believe that this doesn't happen in Durham? If you've heard the testimony, countless testimonies of the interactions between the police and young blacks, you have to admit, and this is what came before the Human Relations Council, you have to recognize that the community has raised these issues, that it's not a matter of just data collection. And when, even though the report acknowledges the Human Relations Council finding of racial profiling, it doesn't really engage what that means in any meaningful way. And I think that's the core of the issue. Mama Neal, who will speak, pointed out that you can't address what is a racial problem in a racially neutral way, and I think that's the fantasy behind this report. I think it's really important that we talk about racism. We talk about the reality of it on the streets in Durham, and if we don't do that, we'll be missing the reality here and missing an opportunity to lead on this issue. I have a small caveat with the report that I want to raise here, because it's implied that the FIP racial training was recommended by the FADE Coalition, and it was not. So I want to make that clear for the record. Thank you.
Phil Wiggins.
Mayor Bell, City Manager Bonfield, members of the council, thank you for allowing me to be here today. My name is Phil Wiggins. I'm a retired captain with the Durham Police Department. I presently serve as the chaplain for our local, state, and national Fraternal Order of Police. I'm here today in support of the Durham Police Department and Police Chief Jose Lopez Sr. Durham has been part of my life for many years, especially the last 5 years where my wife and I lived downtown Durham West Village and developing new friendships and meeting a lot of people. I'm excited about the future of Durham, as each of you are as well. And I can deeply say what happens in Durham that I'm also concerned about the Durham Police Department, where I served 27 and a half years. Durham has been an excellent police department. We have had female, African-American, white, Latino police chiefs. From my perspective, having worked in recruiting before with the Durham Police Department, every effort was made then, as it does now, to recruit officers from different backgrounds and provides diversity training to all officers. Racism is not tolerated by the department. Over the years, the Durham Police Department has embraced the concept of community policing and continues to work in partnership with the community. Earlier this month, more than 100 neighborhoods throughout Durham participated in the National Night Out with the community. Officers visited communities with positive conversation with many of the residents. The police department has numerous community outreach programs where officers work closely with the members of the community. Programs such as the Great Officers in School, Citizens Observer Patrol, and the District Partners Against Crime, to name just a few. I met Chief Lopez and his wife, Rebecca Lopez, soon after they moved to Durham 7 years ago. I can say from personal experience, they both truly care about the police department and the community. Over the past few years, I observed Chief show compassion and support to fellow officers at work, those hospitalized due to injury or sickness, or while attending funerals, and not only would he be there, but his wife would be there with him for support. Ms. Lopez, who is a former police officer, even started a program work with the families of new officers to help them adjust to the life of a law enforcement officer. Both of them love Durham and have truly made it their home. I believe the Durham Police Department and its officers have been unfairly accused of being racist by a few people in the community, and I believe those accusations are unfounded and will continue to be unfounded. The local Durham Lodge of 475 members and the state chapter of 6,100 members of the Fraternal Order of Police have voted to support the Durham Police Department during these challenging times for law enforcement across our country. I ask that the community and the City Council support the Chief and the Department, and the officers who continue to work hard to do a good job under difficult conditions. Thank you for your time, and my prayers are with you as you serve a great city. Thank you.
You're welcome. Stella Adams.
Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, City Manager Bonfield. City Manager, you do not know me because I have been working nationally training civil rights investigators for the past 7 years, and so I don't know you and Chief Lopez personally, but I'm back. And justice begins at home. I have a number of concerns about your report, and I want to start by saying that I do not come here as someone who's a stranger to the Durham Police Department. I worked in the department when it was getting its accreditation. We were one of the first police departments in the state to be accredited, and I worked on that, helping to write those SOPs. I served as the records supervisor for the second and third shifts. So I know a little bit about data collection, and I cannot believe that data collection has gone backwards in the past 20 years rather than forward. So this inability to collect data, analyze data without it waiting 60 days is ridiculous. It's a punch of the button. That's all it was 20 years ago, and we spent a lot of money buying computers since then to make incident reports data sensitive. So 60 days to analyze data and then another 60 days to get it to you makes no sense. But that's not my major concern. My major concern is in HRC recommendation 9-10-11 relating to the section on determination of reasonable suspicion. And I strongly recommend the removal of the language whether the suspect is a stranger to the area. When nearly 60% of your police force is from out of town, how can they recognize a stranger in the area? This is a green light for racial profiling. My children, I live in a predominantly white neighborhood. My sons would be suspicious in that neighborhood. And this is the proximate cause of the death of Trayvon Martin. This should be removed from General Order 4004-2. I also want to say that HRC Recommendation 23, where they ask that a representative be placed from every PAC on the review board, that needs to happen to ensure that all communities are represented and the concerns of all communities are addressed. Thank you.
Chris Tiffany.
Chris Tiffany, Durham, Durham resident. I've prepared this table of contents. I and others are working on comments to the report posted Monday, but I and others, including most of you, couldn't even begin to read it until Tuesday. And it turns out to be a 131-page inaccessible PDF. This table of contents should make it easier for y'all to read and discuss the report. But I must say now that complaints about the complaint system are basic. You can't fix it if you keep it secret from those who can fix it. From the desk officer telling me to take your complaint to the CIA, on up to Lala Lopez refusing to hear or take complaints, standing at the podium pointing at me, calling me a malcontent, telling stories. One guy told me afterwards outside, it's a good thing what he said about you. Malcontent means you're not satisfied and you're trying to make things better. Thank you. A well-run complaint system can help make things better, but police cannot be trusted to take complaints about police. For example, the most important complaint I heard here at City Hall was from parents who complained that they had repeatedly gone to the police department up the chain of command where it was verbal only. You got to talk to the sergeant, but he's not here. You know how the runaround goes. So they came here and tried again and got a similar runaround. So no one filed their complaint that a cop pulled a gun on their 8-year-old retarded child. That was their term, retarded. The CPRB recommendation number one suggests posting the one call number on all police cars. Both the Human Relations Commission and the CPRB and others have had similar concerns and recommendations. Make it true that one call does it all. Complainants should be allowed to use the one call system. It's neutral, professional, and safe. And complaints there can be documented, filed, forwarded without employer contact information, then tracked. So maybe complaints won't get missing and complainants not targeted. By properly, honestly documenting complaints and following up in a professional manner, you'll have information that could be used to improve recruiting, selection, training, supervision, and management. Read CPRB number one, issues and analysis on page 115 of the report. Objections listed there are debatable. Debate them and other complaint-related bullet points on other pages.
Mark Anthony Middleton.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and to members of the council, to the city manager. My name is Mark Anthony Middleton. I'm the senior pastor of the Abundant Hope Christian Church here in Durham. I'm also representing Durham Can here today, particularly the Durham Can Clergy Caucus, who had the pleasure of being one of the groups I led the delegation that met with our city manager, regarding this issue. Durham Can has been and will remain engaged with this issue until it is substantively addressed. We feel it's a direct threat to the fabric of our city, and we have made it a priority. We want to thank the honorable men and women of the Durham Police Department that suit up every day and place themselves between us and anarchy. We pastor you, we marry you, we bury you, we bless your children. You come and talk to us when you've had a stressful day at work. We too support the police department, but we have an issue. We thank the city manager for his good faith engagement and hard work. Your report was long anticipated and moves us in the right direction, but we need to go further. Councilman Brown, you once said that if there's one case of racial profiling, that's one case too many. We agree with you. 40% of our population is not hallucinating, and numbers don't lie. The time for studying and deliberating is winding down, and we are calling on this city council to do what we have placed our sacred trust in you to do and to act. Durham Can is greatly concerned about written consent being held hostage by situational control. This is the situation that needs to be controlled. Every Durham citizen's constitutional rights ought to be protected. We ought not compromise or skimp when it comes to that, and we aren't doing black people a favor. I dare say that if our white fellow citizens were subject to these statistics, no one would be discussing the challenges a piece of paper would present to situational control. This is the United States of America. It's supposed to be difficult to stop and search and detain people. We designed it that way. We designed it that way. If it's too hard for our officers to issue a piece of paper, and by the way, when I was a younger man and used to get tickets, the cops would always walk away from my car to go write the ticket and bring it back. It's not supposed to be easy. It's in our DNA to hold situational control in tension with our sacred and non-negotiable constitutional rights. We are calling on this city council to muster up the political will to erase this blemish on our brand of our great city and let us model for the nation what a truly great and just metropolis looks like. Adopt the recommendations, go further, and let's get back to the work of building our great city. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Mike Evans.
Mayor Pro Tem, City Council. My name is Mike Evans. I'm a retired master officer with Durham Police Department, where I served 28 and a half years. I wanted to continue to serve the citizens of Durham, so I joined the Police Department Reserve Police Unit, where I've been officer for the last 4 years. I serve the citizens now for free. I also serve as the president of the local Fraternal Order of Police, Durham County Lodge No. 2. I'm here today to express the support of Lodge No. 2 for the Durham Police Department and Police Chief Jose Lopez. In my 30 plus years as a Durham officer, I have served under the command of six police chiefs. Chief Lopez is very professional, very fair, impartial to officers under his command, as many chiefs before him. We have read the report comprised by City Manager Tom Bonfield, and we concur with the results of the report. With the implementation of Manager Bonfield's findings and policies, and with the policy revisions that Durham Police Department has already begun to implement, it should put to rest many of the concerns the City Council is trying to address. We agree with the racial disparities and think it should be looked into. However, we do think it needs to be looked into on a case-by-case basis. In closing, Mayor Pro Tem, City Council, we ask you to adopt Manager Bonfield's report and continue to support the Police Department, Chief Jose Lopez, and officers who continue to put their lives in harm's way, work hard every day, doing a great job under difficult conditions in order to keep good things happening in Durham. Thank you.
Welcome. Jesse Gibson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council, for the opportunity to speak to you today. I have the following statement. Mr. Bonfield's public statement that he did not see a need for a psychological evaluation of new police recruits. I sent the mayor and several council members copy of an article which purports that close to 90% of the police departments across the nation use some sort of psychological evaluation or testing as a part of their recruitment of new officers. Two, I also sent you copies of a psychological inventory or tool which measures fitness for continued duty, referred to as FFD, which is administered to officers and supervisors from time to time. It is also used when they show signs of undue stress and de-stress. The tool is currently being used in states such as New Jersey and other cities. There's a need to be in its report. There are needs that need to be addressed in the report that address the human relations recommendations for changes in the composition, structure, and functions of the Durham Civilian Police Review Board. As it stands now, the manager report in its current form constitutes a game which some of us used to learn as children called dodgeball. And number five, while the majority of our officers serve with integrity and commitment, there clearly may be a few who need help or counseling to avoid the potential for further and continued racial profiling, or God forbid, a Ferguson, Missouri, or Beaver Falls, Ohio incidents of black men walking where excessive deadly force was used. In terms of the whole scenario, the Civilian Review Board, as is presently constituted and without changes, is pretty much the proverbial fox continuing to be in charge of the hen house. Thank you.
You're welcome. Rollins, I recognize the city manager.
I apologize, Mr. Mayor. I just want to be sure that I know the council is aware of this, but anybody who has a question, refer to HR 5, all of the background material and the response to correct the inaccuracy that Mr. Gibson just indicated about that issue. Well, I mean, the facts are that we already do psychological evaluations for new recruits. We already do psychological evaluations for stressful situations, critical incident. It's all outlined there. All of the information is there, including a collection of the consistency of both the practice and the tools with peer cities.
Recognize Roland Staten.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, esteemed council members and city manager, and in particular want to recognize and commend Mr. Bonfield and his staff for some Herculean work that they've done, for the openness and candor and transparency with which they have undertaken this assignment and moving forward. My name is Roland State, and I reside at 5005 Kettle Creek Road, Durham, North Carolina. I'm the first vice president of the Durham branch NAACP, which organization also is a proud, stands proudly with the FADE Coalition. With the eyes of the nation turned to Ferguson, Missouri, city split along its seams, a city whose citizens' blood is literally spilled on the street by police officers sworn to protect, city where hate and fear and mistrust currently trump dialogue, transparency, and empathy, we here in Durham, North Carolina, can take some satisfaction in the knowledge that the interests from all sides are engaged in dialogue, that we are recognizing the need for transparency and are recognizing the need for empathy. These are all things that are addressed in the city manager's report. His recommendations are good first steps, but they are not a journey complete. We are all here. All of us have an interest in repairing and improving the social contract between our community and the police department. The city manager's recommendations include an improved consent search form, one that requires written or recorded consent for all home and premises and investigative searches, as well as searches conducted by the HEAT team members. However, it does not require written consent for vehicular searches conducted by patrol officers. And this is where the vast number of these citizen police officer interactions occur. The policy changes around searches are positive. They are definitely movements in the right direction. The recommended data review process will be one of the strongest such policies in the state. But this is, in and of itself, not enough to bring about the sort of changes we are looking for universally to restore all segments of our community's confidence in our police department. One reason why is because the report opposes giving the Citizen Police Review Board investigative authority. This, we say again, is another necessary step in the journey. However, it does support a number of changes designed to make it easier to file complaints and to submit evidence. While the report acknowledges the huge discrepancies of racial disparities in marijuana enforcement, it recommends giving the Durham PD until January 1st to produce a report explaining why they seem to only arrest black folk, literally 86% out of 40% demographic. We are hard pressed to see how this would do anything to stop the ongoing racial discrimination in law enforcement. This report would not exist except for the mayor having directed the commission.
We appreciate it. We want to honor the time. If you could leave your
And I appreciate
remarks.
That.
Thank you.
And thank you again.
Thank you. Jackie Wagstaff.
Mr. Mayor, City Council members, I'm not here to bash the police department because my brother lovingly served in this city for years and he is now the chief of police, so I know law enforcement and I know what they have to go through. But I am here to tell you that I have some serious concerns about your recommendations, Mr. Manager. Oh, first of all, let me read something to you so that we can be clear and not forget. Jesus Huertas, Jose Compass, Derek Walker. This is for you, Mr. Manager. If our police force and their best practices, and you said it today, were some of the best in the state, then why has Durham had so many unexplained murders at the hands of the police department? The nationally recognized police department in Durham. That's my first question. The citizens of Durham are not asking this body and you to do anything beyond what you have been put here to do. I know it's hard for elected officials to step off of the podium as overseers and step back into the citizenship as the servants of this population because we elect you and we put you there and you become the employees of the citizens. So it's hard for you to step down and do the right thing, but you need to do the right thing now. When I read this report, I was disgusted with the recommendations because when I looked at what was brought before you for the last couple of months from eyewitnesses' accounts of harassment, racial profiling, and all of the above, and these were not reports that were brought in here by some single individual that wrote down some stuff when I got a few reports and brought them in. These were eyewitnesses. These were testimonies. And then I read your response about that we need to do certain things to protect the police officers from frivolous complaints. That led me to believe that, in my opinion, and I'm not speaking for anybody else's opinion, but my opinion, that you believe that most of those complaints, if not all of them that came before this body, were frivolous. They had no merit. And that is not true. One thing that you said in your report that may be that I agree with, low-level drug enforcement, marijuana, should not be at the rate it is when it comes to black people being arrested for it. Because I can guarantee you, if you start drug testing elected officials all across the board, I guarantee you that something might drop out in that cup that you don't want to see. Trust and believe. And we have a policy in the city where you can randomly test any employee at any time. I think that elected officials should set the standard. Randomly test yourself sometime, and so that we can be clear what we're dealing with when we come up here and try to speak to you. So for me, I have a lot of other concerns, but I don't have enough time to get to them. But we really need to scrap that report recommendation and start all over again because it did not work.
Thank you, Nancy Wilson. Nancy Wilson.
Good afternoon. First thing, Mr. Mayor, there's a young man who tried to sign up to speak. He didn't understand the protocol. He thought I signed up for him, and he was told no because it happened after you said I have 16. I'm just asking.
Is he still present?
Yeah, he's still here.
All right, if he can go sign up now, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you. So the first thing I want to do before I run out of time is extend an invitation to you all. And part of the recommendations that we've been talking about in the FADE Coalition, we talked about the LEAD program that's happening in Seattle. And folks in FADE have secured some funds to take a group of people from Durham to Seattle to speak directly to the people who are running the LEAD program. So I am on camera inviting Mr. Mayor, Mr. City Manager, there's a few council members that we're talking about. You'll get formal invitations next week. And all of the people that the city manager talked about that need to be a part of this conversation, from the sheriff's department to the DA's office, we'd like you all to take a trip with us to Seattle so that we can have a conversation about how the LLEP and some of the other things that they're doing in Seattle around racial disparities is working. So I hope you'll accept our invitation. Beyond that, Mr. Mayor, I want to remind you that in September you talked about being committed to this process, and I appreciate everything that you've been doing, and I hope that you continue to stay engaged. I would ask you to meet with some of these young men who have some really deep stories to tell you. The harm that's happened here, that continues to happen with racial profiling and police brutality, is very real. We can't expect our black men to lead families when they are being broken constantly by being harassed and oppressed. And that's a reality. And that's a reality across the country. We're not being specific about what's happening in Durham, but we know it's across the country. We see what's happening in Missouri right now. And so these stories need to be lifted up. These men and women need to be talked to directly. They need to be part of the solution. They have been a part of the process that we've been doing with the FADE Coalition, but you actually need to speak with them more directly. So I would ask you to do that. With regards to the police department putting their lives on the line every day, Mr. Shull, what I would say to you is that every 28 hours, a black man is killed in this country. So when my son walks out of the door, he puts his life on the line every day too. And as far as needing to do some more research, which is preposterous to me since the HRC did exactly what they were asked to do, I'll give you this research. Michael Brown, Trayvon Martin, Jonathan Farrell, Renisha McBride, Jordan Davis, Sean Bell, Amadou Diallo, Oscar Grant, Derek Walker, Jose Ocampo, Jesus Huerta, all unarmed, all killed by law enforcement. We're talking about our lives here. Please pay attention.
Thank you, DeCarlo Stanley.
I'd like to appreciate y'all having me in here today. In 92, I went in the United States Marine Corps. I served 4 years for my country and whatnot. I put my life on the line, you know, for everybody to live free, be happy. 96, I became a correction officer. Thought I was gonna help, you know, people get right and stuff. And then here come Durham Police Department. Degrade my character with all these false accusations. I'm just here to say that it's detrimental. You know, I hate going home. You know, they arrest me, send me to jail and stuff. I got to get out, go home, tell my daughter. You know, she asked me, how your day go, Daddy? And I got to tell her, well, it didn't go so good today, Daddy. You know, and, it's real detrimental. I used to work for the city. You know, we got diversity issues and there's a list of things that the city's supposed to stand by, you know, for all the citizens, you know, the citizens of the city. Y'all supposed to stand by the same rules, diversity and fairness, and, you know, they posted up around somewhere, I seen them. But the thing is that, who's doing their job? Who's doing their job? I heard them talk about the safety of the officers. You know, when I was in the service, you know, we ain't, you know, the mission was different. They supposed to be protecting me. They supposed to be protecting them. You know, not, I'm scared to do my job, so I'm gonna shoot first, or I'm gonna choke somebody. You know, it's overwhelming, especially, you know, this done happened to me twice in the past 2 years. You know, getting slammed on the ground, scarred up. You know, it's depressing. It's depressing. And what makes it so bad, I came here, I thought you were going to say something. I thought you were going to say something positive that was going to actually help and actually, you know, uplift some spirits. And I came in here, you know, I heard a little report. Come in here and, you know, you support your police officers, which is good. You know, I got, you know, some police officers took me to go get some gas one day. I was happy as I don't know what. You know what I'm saying? But then, it seems like to me, for you not to want to talk about it directly means you don't want to admit that there's a problem. And if you don't want to admit the problem, we can't never fix the problem. We can't never fix the problem, and it's just detrimental to everybody. You know, so, you know, I heard, I think it was Mr. Shull up there, I heard him say something to Mr. Baker about, you know, it's probably some legality, so you gotta watch what you want to say. Watch what you want to say. What about what I want to say? What about what these people want to say? Or anybody else, you know, and have meaning to it. Have meaning to, actually, Officer Tidwell, Officer Shuley, Officer Beck, These guys beat me up for no reason. And you know, y'all won't even come tell me, call me in to tell me nothing about it, to talk to me.
Thank you, Carlos. Thank you.
Yeah, no. Thank you. Thank all of you. Thank y'all too.
Phil, sip.
Good afternoon, Council, Mayor Bell, and City Manager Palmfield. My name is Phil Seib. I'm the Vice Chair of the Human Relations Commission, and I'm here today to represent the Commission. We at the Human Relations Commission would like to take some time to read, reread, and digest the executive summary put forth by the City Manager. After the Human Relations Commission has had a chance to meet as a body, which will happen on September 2nd, we may want to formally respond to the summary if it is the will of the body of the commission. I personally would like to thank the city leadership and staff for their willingness to address these complicated issues in such an open and public manner. These types of open deliberations with community involvement are what truly makes Durham such a great city to live, work, and raise a family in. I also want to let you guys know that if you have any questions from the Human Relations Commission as far as context or meaning for some of our recommendations, you can contact me or the chairman, Ricky Hart, through the NIS department. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Chris Custer. Sorry about that.
Good afternoon. My name is Chris Custer. I live in Durham. I've been in North Carolina for over 25 years, and much of it in Durham. I left an article with the city clerk for you all. I hope you'll make copies of it, and each and every one of you read it completely. I think it's absolutely vital that Durham not just consider, but get body cameras. I read a stunning statistic. I'm going to read a few things out of this article for you, just some important highlights. Getting body cameras in California led to a 60% drop in police force towards their citizens, with complaints against police officers falling by almost 90%. That is stunning. When I read that, I thought, well, this is an absolute to have. However, the importance of this article is to read more about this because there's a downside to it as well. Another good thing, research has shown that police tend to be on their best behavior when they know they're being watched, policing the police. But just like other law enforcement tools, videos from police cams can be subject to abuse if not carefully mitigated during police reform. One of those abuses would be the LA cops were caught disabling voice recording equipment, such as antennas on about 50 squad cars, most of which were used to patrol the low-income communities densely populated with people of color. Even when police body cams were used, departments frequently denied requests for video footage. And so when there comes to technology, there's potential for abuse. There's many more things in here, but the important thing is oversight on this and who has the oversight. Oftentimes, police have been unwilling to release the videos. What good is it going to do when these cost $300 to $400 a piece? But I think we are at a point of a shift in Durham that at least I notice as a middle-aged white person. And if I do, I know those of color in our community are feeling it beyond what I could ever know. Thank you very much.
Omar Beasley, followed by Umar Muhammad.
First, I want to say thank you, Mayor, for giving everyone the opportunity to speak today. Pro Tem, City Council members, and City Manager Bonfield, thank you for you and your staff taking the time to going through the Human Relations Commission's report and coming back with your recommendations. We also want to thank you and your staff for taking the time to meet with the Durham Committee on Affairs, leadership from the Durham Committee on Affairs of Black People. Once again, my name is Omar Beasley. My address is 3204 Skybrook Lane, and I'm a citizen of Durham County. Now, according to the Durham Police Department's own figures, 86% of those arrested for simple possession of marijuana between January 2013 through July 2014 were African Americans. That's of the 768 total people arrested for simple possession of marijuana, 660 were African Americans. Also, the overall numbers of vehicle stops and searches disproportionately targeted Black men, who represent less than 15% of this population in Durham County. Neither the police department nor the city manager have an explanation for this shocking disparity. The Durham Committee of the Affairs of Black People find this unacceptable. In my opinion, given the department until January 1, 2015, to doctor up some explanation is laughable. The city manager's response to the Human Relations Commission report is encouraging in some respects, but it does not go far enough in addressing the fundamental causes to this critical issue, which is racial profiling. The Durham Committee on Affairs of Black People would like for the city manager to include the written consent forms for all vehicle searches. Councilman Shull echoed your concerns by indicating they would, you guys would not alone solve the problem if the Durham Police Department acted alone. They do need cooperation from the Sheriff's Department, the District Attorney's Office, the judges, as well as other law enforcement. I believe the city manager is incorrect in your assessment, but you should take the lead in reshaping the direction of the police department for Durham by establishing a course of action for others to follow and get to the root of the problem, and not simply kick this can down the road. Discussions with some of these other agencies that you spoke of are underway and have taken place. We can't wait for someone else to go first. We started here with you. Let's get it done with you. Thank you.
Umar Muhammad.
What's going on, y'all? My name is Umar Muhammad. I'm a resident of Durham. I'm also an active participant with the FADE Coalition. This is my first time ever being in this building, and yet this is my first time actually feeling like I have a voice because I'm talking to you face to face. But back in September, you said that you was going to be more involved. You said that you was going to be actively more involved in the discussion. I just came here to ask you to keep your word. Right now in our communities, we're being targeted, and it's not a secret. It's not a secret. I'm so tired and stressed about having to survive out here, and the police department is a threat. It's a threat. I wouldn't call them on my worst day. They're a threat, and that's how my peers in my community look at it as well. I'm up here because I need the mayor and the council to be at the table for the discussion. We need to deliberate this as a whole. I'm from the community. I'm still in the community. I'm asking y'all to come to the table so we can deliberate about this, so you can see what's going on in our communities. I ask that you take Nia Wilson, Mama Nia's invitation and go to Seattle. We have a huge problem in Durham. And it makes me wonder if in Ferguson, if they would have brought their racial issues to the table, would they be going through what they're going through right now? Would we be going through what we're going through right now? I don't need 3 minutes, but face to face, I'm asking you to keep your word. I'm asking all of you all to keep y'all word. You said you was gonna be more involved. We need to see you. Thank you.
let me first again appreciate all of those that have taken the time to come here this evening to share your. I set some guidelines, and I really want to try to keep the guidelines in terms of the persons that will be allowed to speak. To come here and share the comments that you've made, I indicated from the outset that I had not read this report thoroughly, and I had not, but it doesn't mean I won't, because I will. But the value of having comments such as I heard this evening, it allows me to focus maybe on certain parts of the report that I might not have focused on reading for the first time. So I appreciate what you said. To Ms. Wilson, I meet people all across this community, groups, individuals, City Hall, my office, their homes, their communities. I don't have a problem with doing that. So if there are young people that want to meet with me, all I'd ask you to do is to call my office, schedule it, and I'm available. I would prefer to meet with a lot rather than individuals, but I can do that. So I don't have a problem with meeting with people. But I also reserve the right to make a final decision. It doesn't mean I'm going to agree with what's been said, but I do listen. I listen well. So set up a meeting. I'll be happy to meet with whoever you want. Just find the time and the place, and we can do that. This report, and I can echo all the comments that my colleagues have made to the manager, the staff, to the police department. Everybody's been involved in providing input into what we've got here this evening. I take this very seriously. My colleagues on this council take it very seriously. In terms of staying involved, that means different things to different people. But I'm committed to trying to find a solution to the issues that have been raised here, and I'm sure my colleagues on the council are also. We're not going to satisfy everyone. We know that, and you know that. But it doesn't mean that we aren't trying. And Durham is a place where I don't think there are very many cities that are as transparent in terms of what we do and trying to find answers and trying to allow persons to come and express their opinions. We don't always agree, but we hear you. And that's what we've done today. And I can commit for my part that we're going to find a solution to this. We're going to find a solution to this. What I'm suggesting is that our next meeting, which is the 2nd of September, it's a Tuesday, we normally meet on Monday, it's the 2nd of September, that this will be placed on a GBA, that's a general business agreement, agenda, for the council to come back with whatever recommendations they may have for the city manager. I'm not saying that that meeting, it will be settled, but I'm hoping that we can bring close some kind of conclusion, acceptance on what the city manager has represented. This is going to be an ongoing issue in terms of trying to find the solutions. It's not going to happen overnight. Even if we accepted everything that the manager recommended, accepted everything that you recommended, it's not going to fix the problem. But it's something that we've got to stay engaged with, and I'm committed to staying engaged, and I'm sure the council is committed to staying engaged to trying to find a solution to the issues that brought this to our attention, the racial profiling bit, the marijuana use. And let me say this. I know what Councilman Shull has said. I've had conversations with the manager also. I will be writing a letter to the district attorney's office, the district court judge, the sheriff's department, the probation department, and the magistrate's office, as well as the county manager and the city manager, to sit down and have a discussion on how we can deal with this issue of marijuana arrests and giving it whatever the priority that you suggested. We can't do this by ourselves, and I think that's been made very clear. Unless we have the support of the sheriff, the DEA's office, the chief district court judge, the magistrate's office, probation, they've got to be at the table. And I'm not suggesting that we're going to have a wide public discussion about this. I think if those people can come together in a way where they can have frank conversations, we'll find out whether we can get this done or not. So I'll be writing that letter in the next couple of days, and we'll see where it goes with that. Having said that, I'm going to call the meeting to a close, and we have to set the agenda for the work session. And I can only ask that you stay tuned. We do this in the public, and it's not being done behind closed doors and anything like this. It's going to be here at a public meeting that we continue this discussion. So, Mr. Manners, can you?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. To set the agenda for the next for the council meeting, we have on consent items 1 through 3 and 5 through 12. GBA is item 4.
Thank you. Entertain a motion on.
Move the management.
It's been properly moved and seconded. It was moved by the Mayor Pro Tem, was seconded by Councilwoman Cotati. Who, Brown. Oh, Brown, okay. So that, and you see, that's why I have a problem trying to figure out who does the first and the second. Motion made by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Councilman Brown. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote?
I don't.
On the consent agenda? Okay, yeah. Go ahead.
Did I get it wrong?
No, No, you didn't get it wrong. We were just talking over here, and I wonder if it'd be possible, rather than putting this agenda item number 4 on GBA at the September 2nd council meeting, can we bring it back to the work session on the 4th for a bigger discussion? Because, I mean, part of my challenge is I would rather go through this page by page and have a broader discussion, and I don't know what we would do just on Monday night. So that was a question.
The purpose of the GBA, bringing it back to GBA, is that if in fact there's something that the council wants to say, if you want to say you want to receive it now or you want to carry it to the Thursday, we can do that. I'm not suggesting that it be settled on Tuesday. I'm just saying that it's a GBA item. We can have further discussion. Part of the discussion could be that you move it to the work session. So that's the purpose of having it on GBA. Okay. I'm listening, yeah.
The only thing that I'll say is that either on Tuesday we're going to move it to the work session or have a lengthy discussion. So, I mean, those are the...
I may have something I want to say on Tuesday. I haven't said anything other than the fact I haven't read the report. Okay. So I'd like to have that opportunity to do that. Recognize Councilman Brown.
Yep. Mr. Mayor, are you planning or do you think it's wise to have another public hearing on this issue?
Another what?
Another public hearing?
No, this is not a public hearing.
Good.
It's not a public hearing.
I need to read the votes.
That's right. I forgot about that.
For the Durham Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Commission, Emily Aggie has received 4 votes, and Kendra Bridges has received 5 votes. And for the Durham City County Environment Affairs Board, Frank Hahn received 7 votes.
So what does that mean? Are they appointed or not?
No, it's going to be on consent agenda.
Which one needs to be on consent agenda?
This is item 1 and 2 on your agenda today.
Okay, thank you. I guess we're back on setting the agenda. Okay. There's been a motion and a second, and we didn't vote because there was a discussion. Are we prepared to vote now?
Yep.
Can you open the vote? All the machines off, okay. All in favor of the motion, indicate by saying aye. Aye. Those opposed, the motion passes unanimously. Thank you. Meeting's adjourned.